from the first, Methodism was a go-to rather than a you-come-to-us sort of church. Extroverted. And that explains this iconic scene from Wesleyan history. That's John Wesley there preaching, standing in the middle of a cemetery. Well, Wesley had been invited to preach at a church where his father had been pastor. His father was buried out in the churchyard. He got to church, the pastor said, "Sorry, the bishop does not like you and doesn't want you to preach in our church." Wesley, undeterred, jumped on his father's tombstone. He said, "The one plot that I can control." And he said, "I don't need a bishop's approval to preach the gospel or permission. Hey, the world is my parish." I want you to burn that image in your brain, because we're Methodist, working with Jesus. That makes us extroverted. First Bible verse I ever learned by heart was John 3:16. You probably know it. "For God so loved me," and people who look a lot like me, "that God gave his only..." No! Jesus didn't die for the church. He died. The whole world is his. And John Wesley and his followers burst forth into the world, out into the fields and in the streets, proclaiming an expansive, generous gospel, salvation for all. Which makes all the more sad that 80% of Methodist congregations are in decline. Well, we've studied Methodist growth and decline, and we have determined that the single most important factor about whether a Methodist congregation thrives or dies is this: internal versus external. I was a guest preacher in a Methodist congregation, and after service, someone said to me, "This is the most loving, caring congregation I've ever been a part of. We are a family. We look after each other. When one member is in need, we all help and look after them." And I didn't say this, but I thought it. Hey, that's not good enough. We're Methodist. Limiting the church to internal caregiving and hand-holding, inwardly focused, that's easier than the church engaged with Jesus Christ in his mission to the world. We pastors are not supposed to be just professional caregivers trying to keep the customers contented. No, we are Wesleyan missionaries recruiting co-workers to be in the mission of Jesus Christ. Oh, I tell you, when the denomination turns inward and consumes itself in debates about, well, who's in and who's out and who shall be clergy and, hey, who can we exclude? It is a sign of deadly introversion. Mission-minded Methodism that gets confused about the purpose of the church as being the church, the care and consolation of those whom we have inside the church, that's Methodism in trouble. You know, my parents, I don't think they ever worried about whether I would be Christian. It was the only game in town. You became Christian by simply being lucky enough to be born in America. You got to be Christian by osmosis, by just drinking the water, breathing the air. Home and school all work together as props for the church. Well, who believes that today? America, we are waking up to realize, is a vast, unreached mission field. Well, if that's true, that's in our favor. Because Methodism, as we've said, was always a go-to sort of church, not a we'll sit here and ask you to come to us church. Lots of churches practiced hospitality. They had a warm welcome. Methodists from the beginning were always proactive, intrusive, extroverted. You don't have to get on a plane now and go to some foreign country to be in mission. No. The mission field has now become your congregation's neighborhood. And the future belongs to congregations who see this time of a cultural divestment and disestablishment, see that as a time to reclaim our rightful participation in the mission of Jesus Christ. That's our challenge. Luckily, our Methodist polity is the way we do church, is a polity that is formed in the interest of mission, of evangelizing an unreached, unchurched world. Our crises of decline and declension are crises of mission. Don't Look Back contends that your church is your way to take part in Christ's mission. And to do that, Don't Look Back suggests you got some work to do, some questions to ask. First, clarity. Clarity about your congregation's part in Christ's mission in the world. Vision. Vision from where you're to go, from where you are most comfortable and contented, to where God wants you to be. Strategies for overcoming the temptation that every church has toward inversion, and by reaching out, serving, connecting with the surrounding community. Then you got to come up with some tactics, practical means of reaching, integrating, and equipping new disciples. Simplification and acceleration of decision-making and ministry follow-through. Active, resourceful leadership from your pastor. A pastor moving from internal caregiving to external mission outreach. I pray that Don't Look Back will help you do this necessary missional work. Well, Jesus meets with his disciples one last time in Matthew's gospel for final instructions, Matthew 28. And Jesus says to his disciples, "All authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go get some real estate. Remember, location, location, location. Hey, and tell the bank that you're an eleemosynary organization. That'll get you a better rate. And then build you a great, big, overbuilt, expensive to maintain, looks 200 years older than it really is building." No, that's not how Matthew tells it. No, Jesus says, I'm not among you just to gather you. I am among you to send you. Get out. Go. Go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing, teaching them everything I've commanded you, even the hard parts about forgiving your enemies, everything. Hey, It all belongs to me. I want to get it all back to me. And guess who's going to help me? You want to know why John Wesley and his circuit riders didn't wait for folks to come to them, but they went out to where people were. Other churches refused to go in some of those places where they weren't wanted. Methodists planted churches, even when nobody asked for a church. You want to know why that is part of our story? Read Matthew 28. Well, that's our founder, John Wesley, standing over the door of Duke University Chapel. John Wesley welcoming people to the chapel. There he is, Bible in hand. But wait a minute. Is that John Wesley welcoming people to church? Or is that John Wesley, Bible in hand, striding forth from the church? Moving out into the whole wide world. That would be more typical of Wesley. Wesley, with his good news, salvation for all, with Wesley's claim, the world is my parish. Why are there more United Methodist churches in little towns across this country than U.S. post offices? There's your answer. John Wesley, not content to hunker down with the faithful in the church, but always reaching out, finding more faithful, calling in more. The world is my parish. John Wesley and his vision made Methodist who we are and explains why in every corner of the globe, there is some Methodist.